Okay, welcome back to the show. Welcome, Liquid Lunch, coming at you live. It's Tuesday, August 7th, 2012. And Sandra, we are doing a show now.
We're on now.
We're on the show?
This is a pretty freaky day.
Why do you say that?
Just because everybody's energy is all over the place today. It's definitely been a long weekend, for sure.
Yeah.
Don't you think?
It feels like a day that doesn't have a name.
I know, like. So it doesn't really feel like a Tuesday. Let's give it another name.
No.
No, okay.
Not until we go metric.
You kind of feel kind of weird, too.
Yeah.
You're kind of all over the place, too. And we have a new guy in the studio, a new guy helping us.
Lubo's here today. We're very glad to have Lubo working on the show.
Lubo just found out he's Ukrainian.
Yeah.
I should have known, actually. You look it. Welcome.
Are you Ukrainian, too?
I'm
a
quarter.
Oh, a quarter Ukrainian.
I'm a quarter Ukrainian.
There you go.
I know very few people who are 100% anything. Do you?
No, not really. Not in Canada.
Yeah, it's pretty tough,
yeah.
Eh?
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty tough. It's a pretty cool place to be.
It's a pretty cool thing. And now let's talk about, before we get into the show, we got a great show today.
We got lots
of great music and stuff like that. So we're looking forward to that.
The energy is kind of buzzing today.
Yeah. So we're just going to have a good time here on the show today. It's still summer. Long weekend just finished.
But I'm starting to feel the cold now. Are you starting to feel that?
You know, because that cooler air came in and it kind of... And
it's feeling
and even
fall-ish.
Today it is, and I even the light has changed a little bit. I was riding in today, and I looked at it. It's a little September-ish feeling.
Yeah, that's kind of depressing, don't you think?
Yeah, a little bit.
I'm one of those people who just loves the heat.
I know.
I can live in a sauna.
Well, we've had a really long summer. It started in March, so
I know.
It's good.
So maybe this is just a little blip. Maybe it'll go back to the heat wave.
It's still summer, so that's good. So
and
I
want
to tell
rain.
You about.
Okay, sorry. Go ahead.
Rain? Are we getting rain?
Well, we got some.
Farmers need it.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, we got some.
Because I was out on a farm yesterday, and they were talking about that the rain, that the rain's helping, but still there was a lot of dryness.
So we need more.
On. Well, a little more couldn't hurt.
But you know what? Consider ourselves lucky compared to a lot of places, right?
Yeah. So far, so good.
Yeah.
But anyways, we were out there yesterday, and you were going to come.
I know.
But then you couldn't come.
I couldn't come because I have some family visiting, and you know what? We're all girls, and... We can't make our mind up on anything ever. What is up with that? We were supposed to do one thing one day, and then it got changed, and then yesterday it was all over the place, and all the plans change all the time, so I'm pretty much at the mercy of them because they're visiting. So I couldn't go yesterday, so I apologize.
Oh, well. It was okay. We had a good time and found out about pyramids and stuff like that.
That sounds so cool. What'd you find out?
Here's one of the things I found out. The pyramids all around the world, like the Great Pyramid in Egypt and the Bosnian pyramids and all these other pyramids, apparently are shooting energy up into the air. It's increasing.
What's going on?
So wait a second. 2012 thing.
Okay, wait a second. So do we always know it had energy and it's just increasing, or are we just figuring out that it's shooting out energy?
I think they just figured out that it could shoot out energy.
I think a lot of us already knew that, Hugh.
But it's shooting out more.
Okay,
the people
that's
that
amazing.
Are saying that it's shooting out more energy now. And it's because got something to do with, you know, I don't know, protecting Earth from the gamma rays or something like that.
Wow. So who's sending it out?
How's the pyramids that just do that. That's what they do. Anyway,
so why,
I don't
why
know.
Why is it more now?
It's dealing with the situation. You know, the Nibiru or 2012 or whatever.
Are we talking like the ETs and the aliens?
I don't
know
about that.
I think that's what we're talking about.
Okay, well, you know what? I got some videotape of aliens.
We do? Okay, so is there a difference between aliens and ETs, in your opinion? Because you know what? Aliens, when people say aliens... They tend to think bad things. You tend to think they're negative.
You know what?
And ETs, I don't think people think they're negative.
I'm starting to think it's not aliens and ETs. Those are the same things, right?
Okay. Yes, I think so.
But it's like now you're talking about these channeled entities, like the Pleiadians or whatever. Like that's a star system, but these guys are being channeled by channelers. It's like the line between aliens and channeled entities is, I don't know where that line
is. But Pleiadians are actually ETs too, though, if they're not channeled, right? like they're actually beings from another planet, correct?
I don't know. I haven't seen one, unless the one we're going to watch is one of those.
I think some of our guests might be.
Well, we'll find out. We'll get a chance to ask. So let's, before we go to the video, let's just say who we got on the show. First of all, it's Kathleen Fortney, Steve Fortin are here from Straight South.
Actually, we were hearing some of their music beforehand.
Before the show.
And they sounded really, really good.
Yeah, and they're going to be coming on and playing some music from their CD. They're going to do a couple of live things. They came all the way up from Niagara today, so we're looking forward to having them on.
Thank you guys for coming.
Also, Jake Tiley's coming in. He's... I forget his title.
Yes,
but he's going to be coming on and telling us what's going
on
in the world
markets
and stuff like that.
Some sort of financial stock market guy, but it's a much more progressive name now. That's actually a bad term now.
Yeah.
It's got this negative connotation that he doesn't really like.
And John Klotz is here. Okay. And he's going to be coming in and talking about, I'm not sure what, insurance or something like that.
Something about insurance, okay.
And we've got a couple of great performers from the Superstarz contest here.
And Val is going to talk a little bit about a project she's working on. Val from Superstarz.
Yeah.
She's going to talk, we were talking a little bit about in the bathroom on the way up, and wow, it sounds so exciting.
It seems like
so exciting.
It seems like you say the energy is interesting today, and it seems like, I spoke to her this morning, and she had this thing come to her, and I think it's just a good day for that kind of stuff.
I think, you know, to your whole thing about that whole pyramid energy thing, I think I think there is a lot of different energy now, and I a lot of people are following passions more. Mm-hmm. And they're just being inspired, and people are having the courage to go for things now.
Yeah.
And that's kind of like what I'm feeling in the room today. So maybe you brought some of that with you when you came back from the trip. I don't know.
Maybe,
but it's
touched a pyramid.
Did you actually get to touch one?
I touched one.
I didn't even know we had pyramids here.
There are pyramids.
In Canada?
Yeah.
Wow. Wow.
Okay.
That's
so
amazing.
Let's take a little break.
Okay.
We got, this is maybe some alien footage, and you decide.
Or E.T.
Are these real extraterrestrials? And we're going to come back with Straight South as Liquid Lunch gets underway.
Yes.
On June 8th, very early, 3:45 a.m., Abby had a certain premonition. She went to her backyard and saw this flying UFO that was coming down. This flying UFO. This is Abby's backyard. She filmed in infrared this flying UFO that was coming down. So she went running to the field and located again the UFO with this beam, as you can see here, illuminating the ground. Remember, these are images on infrared. On simple view, you cannot see anything. So this action was taking place with this object, with this beam, and as you can see in the ground, it seems to be illuminated. Then the UFO disappeared. So Abby approached the site and look what she discovered. There it is. There it is. This is the object landed. Taped with infrared camera, all right? Now, she felt something moving and discovered this alien thing. And when she returned, look what she encountered. Encountered this.
And head at great speed, making turns in different angles and leaving a luminous tail visible only with infrared camera.
She encountered a strange figure with an entity flying around. As you can see here, an enigmatic encounter. What could be the meaning of this? But then she heard the military helicopters approaching the place. So she returned very fast to her home and got this chopper arriving to the place, taking also photographs that you are going to see in infrared. Taking photographs in infrared. So Abby was frightened, so she remained in her home because of the military presence. But and then contact me, and I told her, go to the field in the morning to see what did you find. Go to the field and look what she found. In the morning, she went to the field where that craft was landed, and look what she found. Strange formations, strange circles on the field. On October 12, Abby has a very strange experience. She went to the field to encounter this deer that she liked to see very often, and then she noticed something moving in the on the tree. Something was moving on the tree. She took her digital camera and took this picture. As you can see here, something is on the tree. So we made this analysis, and look what we found. There was an alien body there, right here.
And we're back on the show here, Liquid Lunch, Sandra, and we've got Kathleen Fortney and Steve Fortin.
Yeah, I think it's a bit of a Welland reunion here.
Well, Steve's from Welland.
Yay, Welland!
Kathleen, I think, is feeling a bit left out, because where are you from, Kathleen?
I am originally from a tiny little town called Pelham.
Pelham?
Mm-hmm.
That's like where Fawn Hill is.
Is
right?
That like a takeoff of Welland?
It's kind of like on the outskirts.
Yeah,
it's further out.
Like where? Where in
Pelham? Like Fenwick is exactly where Fenwick. I was born.
You know that
right?
Place where the rubber boots start to take over?
That's
and the socks. And the socks. I do know exactly. Right. Yeah, they used to drink Black Label.
So you live in Welland now?
No, we live in the Falls now.
Oh,
yeah, we're living in Niagara Falls.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
And wow. You guys together are a duo. Is it just a duo called Straight South?
Yeah, we use on our live shows and that, we usually use tracks just because it's hard to pay a band nowadays.
Yeah.
It's easier to have it right on your side and you can control things that way. But we do, if a band's needed, we form a band and bring a band with us if it's needed and that. When we go down to Tennessee, if we have to play with the band, we just hire guys down in Tennessee to play.
Yeah, I guess there's no shortage of musicians down there. Yeah, and they're probably amazing and can pick up the songs like that, right?
Fantastic down there. Fantastic.
Right. Now, you guys go down there, right?
We do.
Now,
we do.
Why? I hear people that go to Nashville and it's a good career boost and stuff like that. But what is it like? Why do you have to go down there? What do you get than if you were just writing great songs?
We're just recently down there, actually, for the CMA Fan Fest this past
CMA
June.
CMA Country Music Awards?
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
a full 4 days of lots of music and entertainment.
So what was that like?
Oh, busy.
Yes.
Busy. I get like 500,000 people in a small area.
Wow.
They have three stages going, bands going, and like big recording bands. The Thursday night when we walked in down there, there was, what's that guy's name? The big country star.
Rodney Atkins?
Rodney Atkins was right downtown on stage, like right in the middle of the street playing away.
Free he went a concert,
walk
free concert.
And, then they had Kip Moore, and they had, it goes on the list down at one stage.
Oh, yeah.
About five blocks up, they got another stage. They got all Superstarz going on that stage.
Wow.
The whole town goes into like festival mode for this music celebration.
Wow.
Now, were you guys just down there taking it all in, or were you there doing some business and stuff like that?
Yeah, we were down there on business. You asked a question earlier about why people would go down there, and most, I think, a learning experience is probably the best answer that I can give you, because down there, the best from the world. That's why they call it the Music City.
In country music, right?
Not just country no more. They got rockabilly, and they got jazz.
Bluegrass.
They got rock and roll.
Really?
Bluegrass.
So it's really expanded.
So it's a little bit of everything, right? But it's a learning experience. You go down there, and you hear the best players in the world playing in the bars. All the guys that are out with the Superstarz, they want to keep busy while they're off, so they go into the bars and they play on the bars just to keep their licks up and to network with everybody. So that's one of the reasons that you go down there. But we went down there because we're writing with a guy down in Nashville, Tennessee right now.
Very
so that
cool.
was the main thing of our trip, to go down there and talk about our recordings and where all the money's coming from to do the recordings and things like that.
We did do a small show down there, booked through the gentleman that we write with.
Yeah.
He booked it for us while we went down there. It was a lot of fun, really a lot
what
of fun.
Did you get feedback? What was
it went over fantastic.
It was really,
yeah, everybody really, really liked it. And we just put out an EP for that weekend, a couple of our songs. And we got rid of a whole bunch of copies down there and got good feedback on the songs coming out.
Excellent.
On the album that we're working on. So it was a really good experience, all in all.
Well, listen, we'd love to hear a song right now. I know you guys are ready to go. And
sure.
What do you want to play for us?
Well, this song we're actually thinking about putting on the album. And it's an old Pointer Sisters tune. But we've kind of given it our own flavor.
Yeah.
So
maybe you can be the judge whether we should put this one on the album.
Okay, sounds good.
Right. Let us know.
If you say yeah, it's on.
It's going on.
No. Pressure.
riding in your car.
You maybe a diminished chord there?
That sounds cool. I think that sounds really cool.
What do you think? The diminished? You like the diminished? Very good.
I think it sounds great.
Romeo and Juliet, Samson and Delilah, baby, you can bet a love they couldn't deny. My words say split.
What do
you
think?
Well, I'll tell you. You know, it's hard for me to say. I mean, sure, it sounds great because we all know the song.
Yeah.
Right.
Are you the Simon Cowell of?
Yes, that's of it. That's it.
No, it's like sure. I mean, all I'm saying is, it sounds great. Yeah. Sure, you could put that on the album. You could pick a million songs, great songs, and decide to put them on the album or not. But you know, but what about the original music? Like, because.
Now, see, this you is know, an original artist that you can...
Oh, yeah. No, yeah, I agree 100% with that, what you're saying. And we have a bunch of original songs that were... The whole album is original, except for the one song.
That one song we're going to feature on there.
But we have a few plans with this song, too. Mm-hmm. The publicist down that we're dealing with in Nashville, we use a gentleman in Canada, and his name's Paul Gigliotti. Remember the band Wave? Remember the couple big hits?
He had a big hit called California.
He's our producer. Paul's our producer.
Okay.
Right,
mm-hmm.
And he's producing. What we wanted to do with our original stuff, we wanted to take. I'm all country, right? I was born, raised in.
He's a country
farm
bumpkin.
Yeah, I sing country. Everything's country for me. Mm-hmm. So we wanted to mix it a little bit with modern beat today. Your Keith Urbans and your, you know, how country's changing, right?
Yes. Yes.
And so we needed to have a producer that could do it, and Paul was the man for the job, and he's done an amazing job with it so far. But our publicist in Nashville, he also wants one song that was maybe on the pop side to come over and be more on the country side.
Mm-hmm. So, 'cause you know what? Then you're reaching a different audience, correct?
That's exactly.
Meshing. Okay.
So that's why we were talking about that song to come over. It's just a song that people would know as well, too, right? And we do have a producer that were on that particular song that will be involved in it. That's from Nashville himself too, right?
Okay, but here's something. I mean, because I still play in a band too, right?
Yeah.
And what I've noticed over the years, and it's taken years to learn this, is that it's one thing to think of a song that you think is a good song,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
but it's another thing to find a song that that really resonates with you, that you really
right.
deliver, and it
wow.
really comes across well. And
yeah.
I don't know, it's got something to do with the chemistry or the personality,
right.
and the
oh,
song's
got
to mesh with it, but
that's
also you just got to play it, maybe play it in a new way, or make it your own.
Yeah, give it our own flavor,
you know,
not own
just
style.
Doing a cover song, but it's something new and fresh comes out of it somehow.
Mm-hmm. Are you saying don't use the song?
I think he's undecided at
I'm
the moment.
I'm saying, like, you'd have to answer that question. You'd
yeah,
have to answer that for you. If
yes.
if that's
sure,
what it's
for
doing
sure.
for you,
yeah.
then it's
well,
your call.
Well, see, the plan is going to be totally different. Like I say, it's going to have pedal steel guitar in there, and there's going to be a whole bunch of different things happening once it's produced and everything. So we're just giving you the live version.
Kind
of
a updated...
Well,
okay.
you know, I definitely felt the chemistry. There's
oh, yeah.
no.
Do you guys feel
yeah.
it? Do you guys love playing that song?
Oh, yeah.
I really like
yeah,
that
we
song.
Love it.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. But when we do our shows, our live shows, I mean, there's certain songs. It's funny because one night, one song will just, it'll come off like it'll sound fantastic.
Mm-hmm.
And then the next night, another song will take that spot, you know?
That's
it's
right.
always
funny how that
songs.
Works.
But
you
got to find the one that is just a joy to play every
That's
time,
right?
right?
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah, well, that is one of my favorite songs to play.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
And I like
yeah.
how we do it as a, like kind of a answer.
Yeah,
no, that's really
I
good.
Really
yeah.
like that.
Yeah.
That
yeah.
So I think you guys sound really good together.
Well,
and
thank
nice
you.
Harmonies, too.
Thank you. Very, very kind.
Actually, could we hear another one?
Yeah, sure.
Is this an original now?
No. What we're going to do is we're going to play one off our CD. Is that okay to do it that way? Just go live with it off the CD? Yeah.
Off
our website?
I thought we were going to go out with one.
Or, oh, okay.
But I want you guys to play
yeah,
another
sure.
live one if you want.
Okay,
if you
well,
don't
no,
want to,
we'll,
then we're just not
you know
finished
what?
Yet.
Yeah.
We'll sing another one.
Yeah, we can sing another one.
Okay.
For sure.
And this is an original one?
This one, this is another one that we do really, really well. It's not an original, but it's one of our favorites.
Okay.
And it was recorded by Kenny Chesney and Grace Potter.
Okay.
So it's kind of a good duo tune.
Baby, here I am again, kicking dust in the canyon wind, waiting for that sun to go down. Made it up a Holland Drive, hell bent on getting high, high above those lights of town.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Wow. Okay, you make it to the second round on Canadian Idol.
Second round? Okay.
See, is that one going on the album?
I like
it. Yeah, she's great.
That one's not going on
the album.
No. We just thought we'd play that.
That's really nice.
Because, you know.
We like that one.
See, I like that one.
That's, you like that too?
Yeah.
What makes you crazy? Tequila makes me crazy. What makes you crazy?
Tequila makes me crazy too.
You can't.
Hey, we don't have a lot of time left, guys.
That's amazing. Okay.
I don't get the step dance for you?
Ah.
I'm only joking. Time.
Well, we got a couple of minutes. We do want to know, you know, because you guys are working on the record and you're going down to Nashville and stuff like that, but what do we need to know? Like, when can we expect the record?
Well, do you guys have a website or anything like that?
Yeah, we do. Our website is?
It's www.straightsouth.com.
Straight spelled the English
word straight.
Yeah.
And we're on Twitter, we're on Facebook, and our single, actually, Southern Doll, that's on our website. It's also on iTunes and Amazon.
So that's the one we're going to play now. We're going to play that Southern Doll song.
And this is an original.
Okay. This is an original that we wrote.
And it's a single.
We write with a guy out of Nashville named Sheriff Kuzik. And he's linked in with Jamie Johnson.
Yeah.
The big star, Jamie
Johnson. Big recording artist.
And,
wow.
And so exciting. And
guys.
Sheriff writes with us. We're a three-way on writing. Mm-hmm. And this is one of the songs that we wrote together as a three-way.
Nice. So,
yes. A trio.
Nice. Yes.
All right. So,
good luck.
Yeah.
Thank you for having us on the show today.
Thank
and are you,
you
having any gigs or anything around?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Right on our website. That's why I'm so hoarse today, because we're playing 6 and 7 nights a week.
Wow.
Sometimes doubles a day.
And it's been this way since like January. So it's been very busy, thankfully, very busy.
We're very thankful.
And if you go on our website, it gives all our dates. She's
where
got
we are,
and where you can see us.
Are you the brains behind the web stuff?
Yes.
He's not the brains around it.
He just prefers that I do it. He doesn't like all that computer stuff.
I love computer stuff.
Yeah. Uh huh. Uh huh.
Good one.
It's back to the tequila, right?
Anyway, guys, thanks for coming in today.
Thank you so much.
Good luck.
Thank you, guys. It was awesome.
We have you again.
Thank you.
Awesome.
Much.
Thank you so much.
So here's the single. What's it called again?
Southern Doll.
Southern Doll from straightsouth.com. And thanks, guys. And we're going to come back with Sophia and Jacob as Liquid Lunch continues right after this.
Southern song, one shame. How the touch of your hand can make me feel like we're in the south when we're really nowhere near. Make me think of a southern song. One night, one walk in the park. It was just one moon. It was just two hands and two beating hearts. And a little help from above. It turned out to be the kiss before love.
Okay, welcome back to the show here.
Hey. We got some more talent.
We have some talent from the Superstarz contest. We have Sophia Ewaniuk.
Is that
Did right? I get it right that time, Sophia? Okay, great.
Good job.
I'm really glad. It took us, we had to shut the whole station down while I practiced the pronunciation, but it's great. Anyway, great to have you on the show. You guys came in all the way from Oshawa today, right? Oshawa, Ajax. Okay.
Durham
County.
Durham.
It's a big county. Did you ever watch that show about Durham County?
I think he is the only one.
It's set in Durham County.
Durham Region.
I know, but it's set. It's called Durham County.
Oh.
Sounds okay. Cooler than Durham Region. But anyways, you guys are here from Durham Region. Have you always lived in Durham Region, Sophia?
I lived in Toronto when I was a baby, but then I moved out to Durham Region.
Do you remember moving?
No.
Okay, so
you were really young.
I was a baby.
Wait,
baby.
Now that you're embarking on a musical career, though, do you wish you, like, are you glad you live out in Durham region? Do you wish you would have stayed in Toronto? Because this is
no,
the entertainment capital
her,
here.
Yeah, but mom drives her everywhere. It doesn't really matter.
Yeah, I know that. I know that. So, now you're going to sing a song for us now, right?
Yeah.
And do you want to tell us a little bit about the song before you do it?
Okay. I don't know how long it was when I wrote it, but I think a year, maybe,
half your life ago?
I don't know. Well, I wanted to write a song,
yeah.
And I thought, well, I wish I could do this, and I want to do that, and I want to do this. And then you start putting it out into words that make more sense, and then you come up with a melody, and I had lots of fun writing it, and you just...
That's really cool.
So, sweetie, how old are you right now?
I'm 10.
So you wrote the song when you were like 8, you're still single digits?
9.
8 or 9.
9-ish. Yeah.
So still single digits.
What's the name of the song, Sophia?
I Wish.
I Wish.
I Wish.
This is really, okay, this is great.
Wow.
This is what I was saying about this the 2012 stuff, because she wants this and she wants that and she wants to do stuff.
This is going to be like a theme song when you wish on a birthday cake. Before you blow out the candles, this could be this theme song.
And they need a new song for that anyway, because that happy birthday
yeah,
song, you're supposed
really
to pay royalties every time you sing that. You know that.
That just, yeah.
Okay.
That sucks.
So you should be getting the royalties. Yeah. Okay, so you ready?
Yeah.
Okay, good. We want to hear it. Here's I Wish.
And you wrote this, Sophia, looking forward to drinks.
I wish that I could touch the sky. I wish that I didn't have to cry. I wish anything was possible. I wish that I was an aeroplane. I wish that I was a TV or something, or everything. I used to climb so high and never fear to fall. Since believing I could always climb that wall, I wish I could do anything, anything. I wish I could be anything at all, and I wish I could go anywhere, anywhere. It's hard to live between the short and tall. I wish. Enough to touch the gas, but small enough to still believe in dreams that make me smile. If there's a way to be myself and still pretend I'm someone else and live inside a fairy tale. I used to fall so hard and never cry at all. Fearlessly believing I could always climb that wall. I wish I could do anything, anything. I wish I could be anything at all, and I wish I could go anywhere, anywhere. It's hard to live between the short and tall. It's so hard to fight for your direction, and when you get there, they make you start again. I wish I could do anything, anything. I wish I could be anything at all, and I wish I could go anywhere. I wish, I wish, I wish.
Wow, amazing.
Thank you.
That was awesome.
Thank you.
Oh my God, that was beautiful.
Now, does that mean that one of the things you really wish for is that you want to be a songwriter and a singer?
Sure. Yeah.
Okay, what else do you want to, what else do you wish that you want to do? Because you got to plan out your career like early.
Well, you could probably,
you know,
do
you can't
to
just
that
wait
song.
Till like high school to figure this out.
She's on her way though.
Absolutely.
Oh, it's a really good song. It's really good.
It's,
yeah,
it's got a really nice melody, honey. It's really good.
Did you play the piano on that too?
No, I got my singing teacher to play the piano.
Yeah, that's good.
You sing,
good.
So your
you
singing teacher kind of wrote the music to complement the song.
But you had
well,
the melody.
I like I just found a tune in my head, and then she put it into the...
See? That's the way to do it. Well, listen, we got your brother here, too, and Jacob, do you want to come on in here, and we'll talk to you as well?
Because you know what I wish?
What?
I wish I could blow my candles, the candles out of my cake in one fell swoop. That's what I wish.
Yeah. I like it better than happy birthday.
That's what I wish.
So, Jacob, now, here you are. You guys are going to do a little song for us here, but are you a dedicated musician as well, like your sister?
I like to sing, and it's a lot of fun.
As much as your sister?
Yeah. So I think we like to sing.
And you write too?
Stuff? Wow. This song we wrote together. And actually, we finished it last night.
Oh, really?
Oh, my God. It's hot off the press.
You guys. I hope you're well rehearsed.
So Sophia, he procrastinates. He leaves everything to the last minute, right?
No, she's just saying that because she wants the girls to beat the boys. Okay,
what's this song called,
Jacob?
This song, well, we decided that we are going to take this opportunity to sing the song, and it's called
Opportunities.
Awesome.
Oh,
okay.
Nice intro.
Okay, guys, waiting for this. Go ahead.
Okay. A cappella.
Yeah. You wanna be, a superstar, but you wanna do something else. And you don't know, that they come and they go. So be prepared for the future,
because we can do things that we never knew. So
it's time to try them out. You can be whatever you want, 'cause you are you and I am me, and we're all different with our opportunities.
Yeah,
opportunities.
And now you try, what you want, and you're not sure if it's right for you. You live and you learn, so it's hard to get burned, and easy to reach the top.
Because we can do things that we never knew, so it's time to try them out. You can be whatever you want, 'cause you are you and I am me, and we're all different with our opportunities. Oh,
opportunities.
Yeah,
I know that you can find them,
and I know that you can choose them.
So take them when they're there,
and use them with your care, 'cause you can be whatever you want, 'cause you are you and I am me, and we're all different with our opportunities. You can be whatever you want, 'cause you are you and I am me, and we're all different with our opportunities. With our opportunities.
Nice job. Wow. Excellent.
Yeah. Hey, okay, so we don't have a lot of time, but we have to ask you because of that song.
That was an inspirational song.
Yeah, but I want to ask both of you, and I guess we'll start first with you, Jacob, but, you know, because you guys are just kids right now, but you're growing up and you're going to be adults and stuff like that, and who knows what's going to happen, what your jobs are going to be.
I think adults and kid bodies.
Yeah, for sure, but what kind of world do you see when you graduate, say, from high school or from university, Jacob? Well, what kind of world do you think it's going to be?
Well, I know I love entertainment. I love the arts, acting, singing, dancing, everything. And that's what I think I'm destined to do, and that's what I believe I love. So.
Okay, great.
Good
luck with all that. And
That's a handful.
Yeah.
It could start right after this performance because it's part of the Superstarz contest.
It started actually right now. This is part of it.
I know. Now, Sophia, how about you?
Well, I like acting and singing, and I've always wanted to try gymnastics or
gymnastics.
And I paint.
Yeah.
And I just love doing
and songwriting.
Yeah, and like songwriting.
Yes.
Yeah,
yeah.
Of course, it's
right,
fun.
Guys.
Wow, so, you guys are awesome.
Thank you for having me and my brother on
when
the show.
When does the CD
thank
come
you.
Out? If they win the CD, if they win the contest, and otherwise, there'll be another plan. I'm sure there'll be a CD coming out.
I'm sure we're going to be hearing from them.
Now, do you guys have a website or anything?
No.
SoundCloud?
No.
Okay, well, listen, if anybody wants to reach you out, you know, book you for Vegas or some other big event. They can just book through superstarz.ca, superstarz with a Z.ca, or that channel here. And just want to say thanks for coming and doing this today.
Thanks for having us.
Yeah, thanks. And you can also find us on YouTube as well.
Yeah.
Okay, we have under what?
Our names are Jacob and Sophia Ewaniuk.
With spelled with a PH.
Ewaniuk.
Ewaniuk.
And we're going to spell that in the credits, so it's all good. Okay, guys. Thanks a lot for doing this.
Okay, high five.
High five.
Cuties. Oh, my God. You guys are awesome.
Okay, guys. So we're going to take a little break, a little musical break, a little video break. Well, so let's play this this elections thing, video number one, Occupy Elections. And we're going to come back. I don't know. Valerie might come on. Max Brand is here. John Klotz is in the house. Let's take this little break and we'll come right back.
I refer to this presentation as Occupy Electoral Reform for the 99%. Can we engage the 99 in national and provincial decision-making processes by reforming our electoral system? And can we devise a reformulated electoral system that will truly empower the 99%? We will only discover the answers to these questions if we explore the possibilities and find the courage to make changes. And we must, because in the recent Canadian federal election of 2011, the Conservative Party won a majority of seats with less than 26% of the eligible voters using our first-past-the-post electoral system. In reformulating our electoral system, there are four topics that are particularly urgent. These four topics will become a major part of serious conversations in the hundreds of venues where Occupy Wall Street is being expressed. My first topic is election of members of Parliament. For people from all walks of life to have their voices heard, their hopes expressed, and their desires counted in the national and provincial decision-making processes that affect everyone's well-being, it is necessary that our electoral system become more inclusive, whether or not it will be accomplished using single transferable vote or mixed member PR. Some system of proportional representation is necessary to enable the diversity of voices in Canada to be heard and considered. So, where proportional representation is used in an election, then the number of votes that a party receives overall, for example, 15% of the popular vote, is reflected in the number of seats that party will occupy in the Parliament. That is, 15% of 308 seats is 46 seats. In the recent election, the Conservative Party won 53.9% of the seats with only 39.6% of the popular vote, which was less than 25% of the eligible voters. A common outcome of proportional representation systems is that no single party wins a clear majority. Without a clear majority for a single party, all legislation must be thoroughly examined and debated according to the perspectives of the different parties. This often means that parties must cooperate in order to craft legislation that enhances the well-being of all, cooperation amongst and within peoples of different experiences, different cultures, different perspectives is the critical next stage in our social evolution. In a mixed member proportional representation system, members are elected in individual ridings based on a first-past-the-post system in order to make the number of seats proportional to the overall number of votes a party received. Additional members are chosen from a list created by the party. Such a list can be populated by the party decision makers choosing the candidates before the election, or it can be populated after the election. In this latter case, the chosen members will be determined by having received the greatest percentage of votes in their riding, although they did not win in their particular riding. A single transferable vote system enlarges the ridings so that there are between 4 and 7 parliamentary seats being contested in that riding. As an example, in a riding where there are 6 parliamentary seats to represent a large riding, each voter will be entitled to cast 6 votes and will do so in order of preference for the candidates contesting those seats. Each of the parties may field 6 candidates in this riding, and there may be 2 or more independent candidates. In this particular system, the ridings are very large, and some may find it awkward to form a sense of personal connection with their representative in Parliament. On the other hand, this system tends to make the members of Parliament more responsive to the electorate rather than to the party leader. This latter occurs because there may be several candidates from the same party contesting those seats, which then makes the Prime Minister or Premier more accountable to the elected members of his or her party. The frequency of elections will be fixed. 4 years seems like an appropriate term of office for each electoral cycle. This would encourage the parties to negotiate, perhaps even compromise, to make the system work effectively. It may occasionally necessitate choosing a new leader of the government for the balance of the fixed term. In exceptional circumstances, the election date may be changed with a 60% majority of Parliament approving an early election. My second topic is selection of members of the Senate. It is in the selection of members of the Senate where we will find the most radical reformulation of our electoral system. The numbers and boundaries of the Senate ridings will be different than those for the Parliament. In determining the boundaries of each of the Senate ridings, consideration will be given to urban and rural populations, eco-geographical features, as well as historic and social groupings. There will be quotas for male, female, and Indigenous members. The process for selection will be patterned on the successful approach created to choose members of the Citizens' Assembly, which was established to examine electoral reform in British Columbia in 2003 and 2004. Briefly, the selection process is as follows. From the voters' list in each Senate riding, the names of 100 males and 100 females will be randomly chosen to receive an invitation to attend an informational meeting. Those who agree to serve as a member of the Senate for a period of 6 years will place their names in a female hat or a male hat, respectively. Out of each of these hats, one name will be picked to be the member of the Senate for that riding. Ultimately, there will be 2 females and 2 males sitting in the Senate to represent each riding. The selection process will be staggered so that it occurs every 3 years to replace 1 male and 1 female. Thus, for the following 3 years, 2 members will have had experience serving in the Senate, and 2 new members will bring fresh ideas and enthusiasm. A similar process of selection will be applied to ensure that Indigenous populations of both genders are appropriately represented. The purpose of this Senate will be to apply sober second thoughts to the legislation created by the Parliament. The Senate may return the legislation with suggestions to the Parliament for reconsideration. Ultimately, the Parliament can impose acceptance of the legislation on the Senate. Notice that the members of the Senate are not retired politicians, are not chosen by our political leaders at the time, and are not being rewarded for past services. The pools of 100 persons from which a member of the Senate is chosen consist of ordinary Canadians from all walks of life with different skill levels and experiences, and these senators are only beholden to their fellow citizens, you. My third topic is financing elections. The financing of candidates and political parties would be done exclusively on a publicly funded basis. A democracy surcharge would be levied on each taxpayer every year. This would be done with the filing of income tax on an annual basis in the form of a $10 democracy surcharge. All campaign financing would come from this fund called the Canada Democracy Fund. Each and every candidate would be eligible for the determined amount of campaign financing irrespective of past electoral performance or party affiliation. Any political party fielding candidates in more than 60% of the ridings would be eligible for party administration funding. Expenses would have to be filed by each candidate, and those documents would be subject to audit. To be eligible, each candidate would submit the nomination form containing a fixed number of signatures from registered voters in that riding. The number of signatures required might range from 500 to as many as 1,000.
Welcome back to the show. So, the electoral reform, we just saw the video. That's all we have to say about it.
Yes, I know.
Right?
That's,
Well, reform.
All we have to say about that video.
Well, yeah. Well, listen, we're talking about the superstars right now.
Yes.
We got Val Shearman and Max Brand here. Guys, always good to have you on, obviously.
Thank you so much.
Hello, everyone. Good to see you.
Thank you. Thank you, Hugh Reilly, for your support. You guys both, for your wonderful support to some lucky artist out there.
Well, weren't those kids awesome that we just had on, Sophia and Jacob?
They're wonderful.
Yeah.
It's wonderful. Their own words. That's their own lyrics. They wrote the melody, the lyrics, and that's what Superstarz is all about.
And I keep forgetting, oh yeah, it's the Superstarz contest. It means all the music has to be original, right?
It has to be original.
Yeah.
That's the criteria. It's got to be original, written by them, or their group. It could be a group.
Yeah.
Right.
But it has to be primarily original, all lyrics, everything.
And it was great that, it was great that they did the second song a cappella, because it's showing people that, you know what, you don't even have to have the music.
That's
just come with the song, the melody, even if it's not a melody,
yes,
even if it's a form of poetry,
right?
It's just all about being original. So for anybody who's afraid to do that without the music, that kind of set the stage for it.
Sure. Like a Canadian Idol or American Idol, they just got up there and sang.
Yeah.
I mean, they did cover songs, but they can get up there and just do their original song.
Yeah.
And those kids did great.
They did amazing.
I had no idea that, I've never heard the songs before, so.
Well, we're going to tell people in just a couple of minutes how they can be part of the Superstarz contest.
Absolutely.
And,
We're growing.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, it's really starting to grow. And like last night, I really did a sort of a full, sort of a kind of a bit of a promo just to let everybody know about this contest. This is going to be the best, you know, entertainment, you know, original song contest is the homegrown thing, like what Q107 used to do back in the 70s and 80s. And this is like homegrown too. It's just that, you know, there's a lot more than we're going to be, what we'll be doing with it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Where were you last night promoting this, Max?
Well, I was at home.
Oh,
so
on
I
the
was
computer?
At home
on the
Facebook,
computer?
You know.
Yeah, okay.
That'll
Facebook.
Do it. Okay.
And I copied the Kijiji thing from Valerie's, and
I just can't believe, Max, that you actually spend time at home at night, because you're always out in the clubs.
He's always,
you know,
out.
How do you, Max? I know you're busy. How do you find the time to go home?
Well, I was home Monday. I mean, I was out Sunday.
Well, that's good.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Right. So one day.
Well, I don't know how you do that, Max. But anyways, I'm glad you're doing
it. And a man about town.
Yes, a man about town. That's
now,
right.
Now I want to ask you about this, Val, because you had this epiphany. Do you want to just talk about that? Because you had it today, right?
Yes. Actually, it was today. And this morning, I've been, you know, just so the way the world's going right now is a lot of stuff going on TV. And it doesn't get you down. It makes you wonder what's going on out there. So I was walking my dogs. It was just so beautiful. I thought, all the things that are going on this planet, how come it's so beautiful out here? And it's so nice. It's just having a great walk. But something just came to my head. It was a melody, and I remembered it from a long time ago. And without getting to giving away too many details, I had this, it was like a lightning bolt just hit me. And I don't know where it came from. I can theorize.
Inspiration,
someone out there is trying to communicate with me. But this idea came, and I literally was being pushed. I felt like I was being pushed home to get to my computer and start making phone calls, and I did. And as soon as I did make the calls, I couldn't believe the response I got. Everybody wanted to get involved. So what we're going to do is I'm working with Errol Starr that will produce this, which he stated that he's in doing some work with Haggard Hardy from We Are the World.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
And we're going to get Haggard Hardy to help us out in this song and get everybody to sing. Everybody, because
so you don't have to be a singer, right?
It doesn't matter. Just the bigger place we can record this, the better. And it's about standing together.
Okay, so can we record at the ACC or something?
Well,
because I think we're going to need that.
That'll be great, because that's what it's all about. It's about standing together.
Well, no, Val, okay, so I know we've had some interesting conversations on the show here, but what do you think, and you talk about things going on in the world, but what are the things we need to stand together about?
Well, we have to change. We have to change our thought patterns and change the way that we're living. And there's so many people out there that have nothing, and you know, it's got to be more equal. It's about change, and everybody has to be thinking the same way.
So we really want we need to want for others what we want for ourselves.
Right.
Right? Like, so that nobody goes without.
Right. Exactly. Because the same pool that you pick up off the street and you do well, it's you leave without it. It doesn't matter.
Yes.
So while we're here together, it should be equal.
And share.
And
we share it.
And that's what I think it gets a little out of hand.
Okay, Val, you know, it's a great sentiment, and you know, I'm just asking, and you, with the hope that you might have an answer, and I don't expect that you do, but you might. It's so hard when you think about everybody kind of being on the same page about something, because it seems the world is more complex every day. There's options, more things to go in. More opportunities for people to be on different pages.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah, okay. It's very confusing. And people end up going down the wrong path for some time, and they waste all their time, and they go off to veer off to do something else. And all they're trying to do is get ahead, really.
Yeah.
It's very simple. There's so many different ways to go. So I thought, well, before I go and before I leave this earth, I want to make a small change, any contribution, and maybe this is it. Maybe this is my way to, you know, put together this project, and hopefully it can change some minds out there.
Yeah. Well,
maybe it will.
I guess we'll, this is just the first.
This is the very beginning.
Today. This is the day of the epiphany, so
yes.
We're going to follow this.
Yeah, so please follow this.
And I think that's why we felt some the excitement right off the top of the show, because it really was. It really felt like there was a buzz going on.
Yeah, there really,
really
is.
Did. There's something to the project.
And I don't know what it is yet. I'm just going with it. At this point
in
time.
Even in this moment, isn't that exciting?
It is exciting.
Just in this moment, even not knowing, just the anticipation.
That's right. I felt like I went into labor.
There you go. Like, there you go.
Go to labor. Oh my gosh. Get me somewhere. Hurry.
Wow.
That's exactly it.
It sounds really exciting.
It's about change.
Okay.
And it'll come more together, and you'll see a little bit more.
So we will find out more about it as time progresses?
Yes.
Okay.
I have a major meeting tomorrow about this, so.
Wow,
well, we look forward to
you.
All that. So,
thank you.
And then the Superstarz contest, of course, is continuing, and you're doing something this Thursday.
This Thursday,
at Wise Guys. Yeah. We started last week.
Did you go there, Max?
Yes, I did.
He did.
And we only had about three or four singers there.
Yep.
But
very
as I said last night, I pretty much you know put out like kind of a big promotional little you know reminder of everybody knowing about this contest.
Yep.
And I got a email response from a woman whose son is a singer, but you know, and she wants to bring a demo of her son's one of his original songs.
Sure. They can do whatever way they want to do this. They can bring it down, they can get started there. As long as they can perform it, or if they can't and they do want backing from another musician, we can arrange that.
Wow.
We can help them out that way. If
wow.
they want, they don't want to sing it a cappella, we can make sure that they have somebody that can perform the song for them in the back.
Okay.
So that's no problem. So we have some bands coming this week too. Finally
yeah.
some bands.
So it's going to be fun, not just
yeah,
an
yeah.
opportunity for to
it's
get in
great.
The contest, but to see some great
It's
entertainment.
Really amazing how many great songs are out there that these people are writing. It's
and,
amazing.
And it, that's what stuns
really
me, is the caliber of the talent.
I know. And that's what this was all about. Remember, it's about original music, giving them somewhere to take their music and get it out there.
Well, this is why, you know, in the last, you know, 20 years or so, there has not been any decent music the public has been able to embrace. I mean, there have been a few exceptions of some, but there has not been anything that was going to make a big impact into the mainstream of entertainment, because it's always, every song sounds the same.
Yes, it's a machine. It feels
sure.
like a machine.
Or every song's been played before, right,
yes.
Max?
Yes.
It's been played the 60s, 70s, the 80s, the 90s. So we need some new stuff out there.
Absolutely.
Some new
Even
artists.
Even if it was like, you know, digging back like 40 right. or 50 years, you could add some new elements to that. It's just really that, you know, these same artists have probably got enough royalties in their bank account, so enough
right.
already.
There we go.
Time.
That's right. That's right. It's time for somebody new.
Okay. So this
wow.
Thursday, people could just show up
this
there, right?
This Thursday, just show up.
7
it
to 11
yep.
p.m. this Thursday at Wise Guys.
Rise
and
Guy.
Where's Wise Guys again?
It's at 2301 Danforth.
Yeah.
And it's the nearest intersection is Main or Woodbine. It's in the middle.
Yeah.
So
okay.
you can walk
okay.
down from either subway, or there's lots of parking.
And people can, of course, go to the website.
Yes, they
right?
go to the website, Superstarz, with a Z, .ca,
okay.
to look at all the information. They can sign up there, though, if they don't want to. Sign up online, they can come down and sign up there.
And the information on what kinds of prizes is all
what
up there
prizes,
as well, everything?
The qualifications,
okay.
it's 10 plus, you know,
10.
Just some of the things that they have to read through before they come to the contest.
Okay, Val.
So
great.
Come one,
so
come
we look
all.
Forward to Thursday. We could make
yes.
it last week, but maybe this week
yeah.
we can't. Down at Wise Guys. I've already gone there. I like the place.
Yes, it's a great place.
Yeah.
And the staff is great. The food is good. If you're hungry, you haven't had dinner, eat there. And I hear you're a great singer, too. You're going to have to come and sing for us.
I would love to do that. That would
okay.
be so much fun. I would love
oh,
to try
I forgot
to
about that.
Yeah.
No problem.
Yeah.
We're going to get
forgot.
You in there.
We should put a band together for that.
That's
okay.
right. Put her on the spot.
Okay, Val. Thanks for doing this.
You're welcome.
We're going to take a little break.
That's good.
We're going to come back with John Klotz.
And good luck on everything.
Thank you.
Sorry.
John Klotz is here. We're going to talk about, you know, small business people.
I know. I was just actually talking to him. We're going to talk about wealth.
Yeah.
Wealth.
Perfect. See?
I think that's up everybody's alley.
Mm-hmm.
Wealth. Well, yeah. Everybody needs wealth.
Yeah.
Everybody needs wealth. And John Klotz is going to show us how we can
Great.
Get some. So let's take
yes.
this break. Come back with John Klotz right after
Woo.
This. Lunch continues.
Was an expert on electronic eavesdropping, someone with top secret security clearance. Then Mr. Drake essentially sacrificed his career to blow the whistle on his agency's wrongdoings as he saw them. He was charged under the Espionage Act, but only last year the charges were dropped. Mr. Drake, thank you very much for coming.
Thanks for having me.
Tell me about the program that you challenged, working with the National Security Agency, the surveillance program. What was its potential harm as you saw it?
There was the very large flagship program called Trailblazer that was designed to catapult NSA into the 21st century to deal with the vast amounts of data being generated from the digital age. Given the massive fraud and abuse that NSA had created with the Trailblazer program, as well as a super secret surveillance program, they had completely violated the Constitution and the Fourth Amendment, and in particular, the statute called the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act, which was the first commandment at NSA, you did not violate Americans' privacy without a warrant under that statute. And in fact, if you did, there were criminal penalties for doing so. And I found this out to my horror and shock, shortly after 9/11. The NSA had entered into a secret agreement with the White House in which NSA would become the executive agent for this secret surveillance program. On the front end was designed to deal with the threat, the terrorist threat, and that was partly understandable. But what it did is it actually essentially turned the United States into just a collection platform. So, you know, vast reams of data were increasingly being collected or through other entities being made available to NSA for analysis.
There's a lot of debate about this proposed legislation. I'm sure you heard about it, the CISPA, which in the name of national security would allow web service providers to funnel private information of their users to the authorities, to government agencies. Aren't they already doing that? I mean, many argue that providers, you know, Google, Facebook, and other companies, they need that legislation to protect themselves from being liable for what they're already doing. And that's why those companies lobby for the bill.
Well, I believe that's part of it. The other part of it is the government just wants even more access to even more data. And so, I mean, under the Patriot Act in Section 215, there is a secret executive interpretation of that, which essentially grants the government pretty much unfettered access to subscriber information that's held by those companies. CISPA would take that to, and there's other variants of that, would take that to the next level. You know, under the label or the rubric of you know, cyber threats, and to provide some cybersecurity, the government wants even more invasive access, almost persistent access to networks that are not normally available to the public.
I understand the technology is so advanced now that it is probably so very tempting for intelligence agencies to siphon all that data. But what is the goal? Is it total surveillance?
I believe if you take what has been happening since in kind of our post 9/11 security world, what you're seeing is the establishment of a surveillance society. You're seeing the establishment of a surveillance network. And I keep telling people don't realize the extent to which we're already surveilled in many, many different ways. The extent to which vast amounts of our own transactional data in all forms, all electronic forms and emails and your tweets and bank records and everything else are all subject or suspect, okay, in terms of surveillance. It raises the specter of kind of the rise of soft tyranny. It raises the specter of you're automatically suspicious until we prove that you're not. It raises the specter of a universal, I call it a universal wiretap, a persistent universal wiretap on every single person.
Playing right now on that channel.
That was it. Yeah, John, we took a little clip from the RT, the Russian TV. You know it's true if the Russians are talking
about
it.
You know what? I know a lot of people who watch that show, who watch that channel. It's an amazing...
Well, because it's a counterpoint to what you get from the American mass media.
I think there is a lot more, a slightly different perspective. And I think a lot of people go there for truth.
Well, for something different. But that's not what we're here to talk about, right, John?
No, sir. The truth.
Okay. John Klotz is here. I know you're just joking about that, John. Because I know you're going to be telling us the facts.
Just the facts.
Right?
Yes.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Well, you know, it just hit, as we were talking at the beginning of the show, it's just hitting both of us and probably starting to hit a lot of people. The summer's coming to an end. We're, you know, August is almost a quarter of the way through, people have to start to think business again, right?
Exactly. It's back to school. That's sort of the time people redefine goals and think about what they want to do. And certainly in my mind, even though I've been out of school a while.
Well, it's back to being busy again in September, and it's a totally different
mindset. Well, it's back to the structure
mindset.
Again, right?
Yeah.
It's back to everybody's back in school, you're back at work. Even, you know, even people who hire, usually it's nobody does any hiring during the summertime. All of that. So it's like, you know, you start planning. September tends to be when
Absolutely.
You get back into the whole seriousness.
Exactly.
Well, and here we are. We're headed here, John. And you're here to help business people. And it seems to me everybody's got to be thinking business these days.
You know, that's what we're really good at is we work with business owners, Canadian business owners, regarding sort of wealth management and risk management. And because there's a real, you know, there's people like yourselves, you know, who have businesses. And yet there's things you need to do that can improve your situation. And anyway, that's what we want to talk. That's
well,
what I'd like to talk
about
that.
And you got 10 tips for
us,
right?
Yeah, so I thought in the time that we had, I'd talk about 10 tips. Now, as I, my little disclaimer, always speak to your financial advisor, because I'm just going to throw some ideas at you. But really, tip number one, and for anybody who owns a house or has a mortgage, is set up a home equity line of credit, as opposed to a traditional mortgage. And the reason I like these things is because, as you know, mortgages accumulate interest all year long. With a home equity line of credit, you can actually take years off your mortgage, which
you
is
mean instead of a mortgage.
Instead of a mortgage.
So can you get a line of credit as much as people have for a mortgage?
Yes. In fact, there are certain programs out there, certain institutions that will loan you up to 80% of the value of your home. And here's how it works. I'll just give you some insight, and then I'll talk about how it helps a business owner. So they loan you up to 80% of the value of your home. And what you do is you drop your paycheck into that and every month, and it actually reduces your mortgage by your paycheck. And at the same time, all your monthly withdrawals are coming out of it. But if there is a difference in your favor at the end of the month, you've actually reduced your mortgage by that amount. And there's all sorts of calculators out there, and it does take years off the life of your mortgage, because every single time you pay down your mortgage or you get your paycheck, you pay down your mortgage. Now here's the other neat thing. As a business owner, businesses need cash. Well, the cheapest loan you're going to get is from your home equity loan, your home equity line of credit. You can actually loan yourself the money to run your business. You can deduct it, right, because it's a business expense, from your line of credit.
Okay, but if you are using your line of credit for your mortgage, 80% of the sale of the price of your house, you, how can you do that on top of getting money for your business on, as well?
Well, that's, hopefully there's a little bit of a buffer there.
Oh, okay, okay.
And there are certain products out there that allow you to differentiate between the mortgage and the money that you're investing in your business.
Okay. Okay.
And that's actually really cool. So, and as you know, with my our company, Northwood Mortgage Life, I am surrounded by a number of mortgage agents who actually are really good at this. But that's kind of something you can do. It's not, it's just a product that's available.
Okay, see, and that's something I've never heard of before.
Yeah, that's
so that's
cool,
a really neat thing. And you know what? And we could probably talk about that one tip alone for the whole show. But let's go through these tips, and because people can get in touch with you, John, if they need more details, right?
Absolutely. We're here to help. Another tip, and this is for business owners again, is set up a health spending account. Now, you know, the interesting thing is when it comes to health and dental benefits, a lot of people, when they become self-employed, automatically want to replicate the health and dental plan that they had at their old company. But it's different, because when you're self-employed, there are, what you want to do is buy insurance for things that need to be insured, like if you become disabled or you get sick and need really expensive drugs. You don't want to insure things that are not insurance, like a dental plan. So if you look, for instance, at a typical dental plan, they cost about $50 a month, and they give you about $600 a year of benefit. Do the math. It's basically just a wash. What you want to do with that, it's not really insurance. What you want to do with that expense is write it off. So what you do is you set up a health spending account, and you put $100 a month into it, and you get to deduct.
As if it's insurance.
Right, you get to deduct $100 a month, and then you end up with this little spending account that you can use to pay the things that aren't really insurance, like your dental bills, your prescription glasses. On top of this, so that's a tax deduction, it's not insurance. On top of this, a lot of these plans include things like catastrophic drug plans. So if you do get really sick, it will pick up those expenses, and that's insurance.
Okay.
So those are some things, and like I said, very often people, I work with a lot of IT consultants who were at IBM for the purpose of discussion, where the plan was very rich, you know, include orthodontia, all that sort of stuff, and now they become self-employed and they go, I want that plan, and you go, no. What you want to do is get insurance for the things that need to be insured, if you become disabled, if you become really sick, and the rest of it, what you want to do is create a tax deduction. And that's a good way to think.
Interesting.
As a business owner. It'll save you a lot of money. If you think that way about insurance, you will save yourself a lot of money.
Yeah. Okay.
Interesting.
It's like self-insurance.
For the things that aren't insurance.
Exactly. Okay, John. Next one.
Okay, let's see.
We've got to get through these. I'm writing them down.
Number three. Individual pension plans. They're called IPPs is the little acronym. And let me explain. These are ideal for a business person who spent his younger years building his business and said, forget about retirement planning. I have to build my business. And I meet these guys all the time, right? I mean, I'm sure if I spoke to you, Hugh, I'm sure, you know, your energy has been devoted to building your business. And sometimes these people start hitting 40, 45, and 50 and go, wait a second, I didn't contribute to RSPs all these years. And I'm way behind the people who did, who were working for a company or whatever. So with an individual pension plan, what the government does is they say, okay, we said you could have a pension equal to about $2,000 a year for every year that you worked. So let's say you started when you were 20 and you retired at 65. That's a 45-year period times $2,000 is equal to about a $90,000 pension. And Revenue Canada says, starting at 45, you can condense this period of time and say, I need to create a pension of $90,000. What's it going to cost? So suddenly your contribution levels are significantly higher than RSPs. Not only that, the company pays for it. The company pays for it, creates a deduction for the corporation, and you, Mr. Business Owner, get the pension. And it's creditor protected.
Wow.
So it's just an idea. And again, there you go. You're getting ideas.
Who thinks up this stuff, John?
It's out there. It's out there. It's just finding the right advice. That's the key. That's the key.
It all ends up getting funneled to you, and then
how many people actually know this?
Well, it's not for everybody, right? And the things I'm talking about aren't for everybody, but it is. There are some. You know, your accountant knows a lot about these things. Your financial advisor, and very often it's a matter of having a discussion with somebody who's in the know, and knows your situation, and can say, here's the appropriate solution for you. And so you're asking me, I'm telling you, that's what we do. We work with business owners, we listen. Actually, I know I'm doing most of the talking today, but most of our job is to sit there and go, and why is that, and where do you want to go?
To understand the client, what they need, and then give them the best recommendations.
Absolutely.
Okay, what's the next one there,
okay, John? Tax-free savings account. Now, obviously, a lot of people know about these. I don't know if you guys have tax-free savings account. I love asking personal questions on an internet show. You guess Hugh kind of shifts in his seat.
We'll put it in the credits.
This is where you see Hugh shut up.
Yeah, exactly. You don't need to divulge anything. But a lot, you know, the tax-free savings account came out a few years ago. And
we heard about it, right, Hugh?
Yeah.
He knows everything.
I do know.
He knows everything.
Because we've talked about that before, John.
And there's some confusion about what they do, but I'm going to talk about RSPs. I'm not a huge fan of RSPs because there's a tax bite when you withdraw them, but they do have their place. But with a tax-free savings account, what happens is if you invest money in it and it grows, if you invested $1,000 and it grows to $5,000 and you withdraw it, you don't pay any tax. So these are really great things to accumulate for, you know, retirement planning, for saving for a car or a cottage, is a tax-free savings account. And you're allowed $5,000 a year. And so at this point, you can put in up to $20,000 because it was started in 2009.
So if you didn't put anything in up to this point, okay.
And they do have a carry forward. I'm not sure how long I'm not putting any alarm in. I'm not sure how many more years the carry forward will continue on for. Okay. So I'm saying, at some point, I haven't heard anything specific, but I'm not sure, if how much longer that will go on for. Tip number five, universal life insurance. Now, obviously, the insurance has a certain stigmatism, but did you know that life insurance is a great way to accumulate money? And I'll tell you why. If you invest in an insurance policy, they have investments within them. They have various mutual funds. They have exchange-traded funds. If you put money into the fund, it accumulates tax-free, just like an RSP. So I have certain clients who've maxed out their RSP contributions, have paid down a significant part of their mortgage, and say to me, what else do you have? And I say, well, you actually do need life insurance because you have various dependents. Here's a way to create a fund that will accumulate money tax-free. I have a couple of my clients, one of them puts $250,000 a year into one of these policies. So he's accumulated, and it invests in various market indexes. You can do corporate bond funds, because we'll talk about that. We know the market's shaky. You can put it into equities, you can put it into bonds, and whatever it grows to, you're not taxed on any of the growth. Here's the very interesting thing, is that at retirement, you have the ability to take out the money tax-free, and let me explain. With an RRSP, and you may not be aware of this, when you withdraw money from an RRSP, it's considered completely taxable.
I knew that.
I'm not sure if you knew that, Sandra.
Yes,
so very often when we deal with well-heeled seniors who've done well in business, they find themselves starting at the age of 71 withdrawing money from their RSPs, and they're hit with a significant amount of tax.
Yes.
Because it's very possible to accumulate a couple of $1 million in an RSP if you start early enough. Mm-hmm. And at age 71, the government comes along and says, we want you to start taking out 7% of that. So suddenly, at age 71, you have an income of $70,000, 7% of $1 million,
okay,
for the purpose of an illustration. So the ramifications of this, if you have any additional income, if you have business income, you find a lot of well-heeled seniors aren't huge fans of RSPs because they're fully taxable. With the money accumulating in an insurance policy, what you can do is up to a certain level, you can take it out an amount tax-free because it's called an adjusted cost base of the policy. I'm not going to get into it. But above that, you can assign the money as collateral for a loan. So let's say you're like my client who's putting $250,000 into this policy and you accumulate $1 million for the purpose of a discussion.
Okay.
You take that $1 million in the policy, you assign it to the bank. Now the banks love these policies because they're with big companies like Canada Life, Manulife. They go rock solid, you've got $1 million here, we'll take it. You assign it as collateral for a loan, then you take out a line of credit. And when you take money out of a line of credit, there's no tax. So suddenly you've accumulated money tax-free, you sign the money as a loan, take it out as a loan, and you're getting excited. Like,
it sounds wonderful, wondrous.
Yes,
John.
It's that $250,000 a year.
It's complicated.
No, it's not. But let me explain.
That's why you're here.
Thank you, Hugh, because I thought you were following.
No, but he knows what he's talking about.
So you're asking me, I'm trying to be as simplistic as possible.
Okay, so we're in really
bad
shape.
So here's the deal. You can accumulate money and not pay tax on it when you withdraw it.
See,
end of story.
That's it.
There you go.
See, but
sorry.
He knows how to do this stuff.
Sorry, I apologize. Yes, but it's good. And a lot of the thing is, it's off the beaten path. But it's really not. A lot of people do this.
I know, but a lot of people don't know about it maybe till now.
Yes.
Right?
But the other thing, too, is you just talked about a client who has $250,000. So that might scare people off and think, well, you know what? I don't have that kind of money.
Right.
So how about people who don't have, like, who have $5,000?
Exactly. Exactly. So I'm just giving you an example. I mean, I'm sort of giving you the one extreme. People do a lot less than that. But we're just talking about accumulating money within a policy.
Yeah.
You know, one of my clients puts an extra $5,000 or $10,000, which is equivalent to kind of RSPs. But you're absolutely right. I don't want to scare everybody.
People, yeah.
But I know the high net worth of your listeners is significant, because I just assume that.
That's right.
Because rich people watch internet TV.
That's right.
No, I'm having it. But you know, you look at those two kids who are here. I mean, if they have a great career, but anyway, you're absolutely right. The amounts do not have to be that. But this is something, you know.
Yeah.
These are
so
ideas.
You deal with people of all income
of
brackets.
Of all incomes,
right?
You know. And it's funny. I look, when people ask me what I look for in clients, there's really two qualities. I want them upwardly mobile, and I want them to be nice. and I'm not sure which one comes first. Because it's their long-term relationship. You have to be nice.
Yeah.
but anyway, so all different strokes and significant business owners, all the way down to the, you know, one or two person.
Okay, so anybody who's out there that needs this kind of stuff. But John, I can't believe we're only through five. Let's get through the rest of these things.
Oh, that's right.
Universal life insurance. I'm writing it down.
I know. And by the way, I'll just say at the end, we have our tax tips, which we can email to anyone who's listening to this show in more detail.
Okay.
And absolutely. So if you don't have to take notes, you can get a copy of this. Tip number six, if you own a life insurance policy and you have a corporation, consider selling the policy to your corporation. Now, why would you do that?
Yeah, why, John?
Well, okay. the way taxes are set up in Canada, they're really set up for business owners. Mm-hmm. Because business owners are taxed at about 16%, 16.5%, whereas the highest marginal tax rate is 47% for individuals. So,
unbelievable.
Isn't that amazing?
That's shocking.
Is it? Well, it's
we're helping
the way it is.
Entrepreneurs.
That's
John,
shocking.
That's what we're doing.
If you want to create wealth in Canada, be a business owner. Yeah. Seriously.
And be a business owner anyway.
God. See, that to me is the most important point of all of this.
There you go.
Just be a business owner.
You mean it wasn't the $250,000 into the universal life policy?
Okay, John. No,
that's too complicated for me.
I know. Sorry. Okay, fair enough. No, but I agree with you. So
holy
the
cow.
Simplistic thing is if you have a corporation, that's where
the tax system was made for business. Oh,
yes.
My God.
Yes. Yes.
You know what? That makes a lot of sense.
And I have
though.
A few more issues about the tax system, which the tax systems are not set up for families. I feel that they're because
that's
you know
another shock.
Shared income.
That's another
yeah, there's
shock.
A couple of other things. But anyway, to answer your question, yes, where do you want to hang out? Hang out in a corporation where you're taxed at 16%.
Okay.
So what you can do is if you own a corporation and you're in one of these high marginal tax rates, you can say, okay, I'd like my corporation to own the policy because it's going to pay the premium at a 16% tax as opposed to 47%.
Now I understand that. I get that one.
Now it's even better. If you have money in the corporation, and many of our clients keep money in the corporation, you can sell the policy to your corporation and there can be a tax-free windfall. The company actually has to pay you something for your policy. And if you own the corporation 100%, well, you just sold it to yourself for a tax-free
distribution. Don't tell Conrad Black.
It's not illegal. Nothing I'm talking about is illegal.
But that's the problem.
I see how
Once
you're thinking.
Stuff gets out there,
no, I know it's
see
not.
See how he thinks.
Well, Conrad Black doesn't think he did anything illegal either.
Nothing's illegal here. But it's a good point.
Okay.
See how his mind
it's
works?
A good point.
Look at him. Okay. All right. Now, these are legal.
Okay. By the way. Of course they are. Just don't destroy the documents before the case. And don't get caught
on
video.
I don't know what's going on under
okay.
that.
Okay. Where are we? Should I keep
just
going?
No.
Yeah, please.
All right. Group RSPs. Now, this is a great way to buy your RSPs if you own a corporation or if you are an employee in a corporation, because you can buy your RSPs with pre-tax dollars, which is really cool. It's like buying them wholesale versus retail because you get your refund all year long.
And then this is a group RSP.
Yeah.
How many people have to be in the group?
One. So if you have a corporation, you can set up a group RSP and do a deduction right
at source. I'm sorry, but this is so stupid.
Why is it?
Because it's just ways to dance around to do the same thing.
Yeah. Yeah, but it's smarter. Well, it's...
It is, but who would have thought a group RSP is one person?
Yeah, I have companies with one contributor, and it's a group RSP. It's a payroll deduction, so there's a little bit of maintenance there, but not a lot, and you get your deduction all year long.
That's just funny.
See,
yeah.
It's just the expertise that John's bringing to bear on this. Well, okay, right. John, next one.
All right, tip number 8. If you're going to buy your RSPs and you are a business owner,
your group RSPs, because
group RSP or individual, I'm just giving you options. You should buy them through an insurance company. Now, why would you do that? Creditor protection.
Okay.
Now, the insurance companies actually came out with RSPs. They're the ones who started marketing them back in the 50s, and they were given the mandates. Now the banks are very involved with them. But if you go bankrupt, there are certain rules that are favorable to insurance companies, such that your creditors can't seize the RSPs in the event of a bankruptcy. Now, the rules changed a few years ago. They became a little bit more favorable to the banks.
Okay.
So it said basically, if you have RSPs with a bank and you go bankrupt, they can't go after all of it. They can take the last years of contribution. But with the insurance companies, you don't have to go bankrupt. You can just say to your creditors, you can't touch this money. So it's still got
it's
an advantage. Yes, and as a business owner, mm-hmm. we're very concerned about this. We're very concerned mm-hmm. about creditor protection. Mm-hmm. We want the assets protected. Mm-hmm. And under the Insurance Act, if you mandate a family member, husband, wife, child, parent, as the beneficiary, no one can touch your RSPs.
Wow.
It's very cool.
See?
Tip number 9. How are we doing, by the way?
I want to get those notes.
See?
Okay. All right.
Okay.
Tip number 9, consider deductible non-registered investments. So here's...
What is that?
Okay, well, I'm not going to overcomplicate it, but I will say here's the problem with RSPs. I think we alluded to it, is that when you withdraw them, there's tax, right?
Okay. Right. Single RSPs, not group RSPs.
Doesn't matter.
Oh. Okay.
Doesn't matter. RSPs, whether they're group or individual, when you take them out at the age of 71, you'll be taxed on the total amount, whatever amount you take out. So why do people buy RSPs? They buy RSPs because they get a tax deduction, right?
Mm-hmm.
Which is important. And the money accumulates tax deferred,
mm-hmm.
okay?
Mm-hmm.
It's not avoidance. You do pay tax when you withdraw them. So wouldn't it be great if you could create a deduction similar to an RSP,
uh-huh.
but create investments that when you withdraw them, aren't taxed as heavily? So here's what my clients do. They take out a loan for investment purposes, and this scares people, but it's very doable. They take out a loan for, say, $50,000.
Okay.
Don't get scared. And at, say, a 6% interest rate, that creates a $3,000 interest cost, right?
Okay, yeah.
That is completely tax deductible if you invested in something that produces interest or dividends. So what you do is you take this 50 grand, you put it into an investment.
Okay.
An investment, you don't want to be, you don't have to be very aggressive, you want to be kind of boring with this.
So a safe investment.
Safe investments, but something that's going to generate some form of interest or dividends so you can deduct the interest.
Can you give us an example, bonds?
Well, I'll tell you, I can give you an example. Do you own mutual funds?
Okay.
You can put it into a managed piece of money, but even better, you can put it into a managed piece of money where there's a principal guarantee, such that at the end of 10 years, regardless of how the market performed, you get your money back. So if the market does a big slide, does a big slide, you get 100% of your principal back. That you can do. And if the market goes up, then you participate in that and you deduct the interest. At the end of the day, you get to pay a preferred tax, which is capital gains. And I'm going to make a very specific example. Here is the problem with RSPs. If you invest $1,000 into an RSP and it grows to $5,000 and you withdraw it, you pay tax on the full $5,000.
Wow. Okay.
If you invest $1,000 outside of an RSP into, say, a non-registered account, and it grows to $5,000, well, they say that first $1,000 is your money. We're not going to tax you on that. The remaining $4,000, we're only going to tax you on 50%, which is $2,000. So where do you want to be?
But the non-registered one, you did pay tax on.
Right, you deducted.
But whereas the registered one, you don't pay tax on the beginning. So that's the tease, right?
Difference. Yeah, exactly. So what they've got investments that really limit the distribution of interest and dividends on the non-registered. They're really, they just produce enough to make it viable for tax deductible purposes, but they really limit it. So you pay very little tax. Okay. It kind of grows like an RSP. But again, you're only paying tax on $2,000 versus $5,000, and that should be the big wake-up call for you. And again, it's all about business owners. Business owners pay capital gains tax.
Everybody.
Canadians pay earned income tax. So
everybody should be a business owner.
Yes, and we are basically. We're all business people.
Sure.
We're employees.
We have to be responsible for ourselves anyway. So even if you're working for somebody, start a business.
Exactly.
Yeah.
100%. Tip number 10. Consider making your disability insurance premiums tax deductible to your corporation. So very often, I work a lot with individuals who, and one of my target markets is IT consultants.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a lot of men in that business. So very often I'll meet John Smith IT Consultant, and he'll have his company, John Smith IT Consulting Inc., which is sometimes as creative as they get. And he, this is true, he will be the breadwinner, and he will need disability insurance because he's self-employed. And he will have a stay-at-home spouse who does the books, but he does some income splitting with her. And what he'll do is he will say, okay, there are two directors of my corporation. There's me and my wife. As a result of there being two people in my company, I can take out a fabulous disability policy on me. I can take out a completely dreadful policy on her that I've gotten as cheap as $8 a month. I then set up what we call a wage loss replacement program, and we can deduct the whole premiums to the corporation. And that is tip number 10. Make your disability insurance premiums tax deductible to your corporation.
How do we get this? We need to be able to get this.
Okay. Well, so the best way is to speak with an advisor. You can reach us. Our website is northwoodmortgagelife.com. Okay. You can email us if you'd like a copy of our tips at info@northwoodmortgagelife.com.
And what do we ask for?
Just say, I'd like the tax tips.
Okay.
And if you'd like to call us and speak with us, you can reach us at 416-969-8130. We're extension 230.
And you know what? The thing that gets me is, even if you have trouble understanding some of this stuff,
yes,
and even if it seems above your head or beyond...
He looks at me as he says that.
I think you got it.
I have to look at somebody.
I know.
I'm just saying...
I think you got it.
Or lube.
That... Well, I'm just saying, John, that they just need to call you, and you've got the inside scoop on how to get all this stuff done.
Actually, we can help.
You did make it pretty. You did dumb it down, so I appreciate that.
I think it's just a matter of you hearing it, and if you hear it a few times, that's great because it's just not what you guys do, right?
Yeah.
It's not, and that's the people we work with. They're very focused on building their businesses. This is nice, but they're focused on building their businesses and
well, you can't wear every hat, right?
You cannot wear every hat.
So work with a professional, like John.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Okay, John, great to have you on the show.
But you have to be nice and upwardly mobile.
Nice and upwardly mobile. That's all we're looking for.
Or John's not working with you.
That's all we're looking for. I'm not sure in which order, but that's the key.
Okay.
Thank you for having me. It's been an honor. Thanks.
Okay, John Klotz, great to have you on. Thanks for doing this.
Thanks.
And I guess that's it for the show, Sandra.
Okay, we're going to high-five it just like the kids. Yeah.
High five. I was giving them high fives out in the hall even.
Were you?
Yeah, they were still doing the high five stuff.
It's kind of like medium five, though, because they're small, right? You can't really do a high five.
So let's just thank everybody for tuning in today. Thanks,
thank
Aaron and Lubo, for doing
you.
The
Welcome,
tech here
Lubo.
Today. And thanks all our guests and John Klotz and everyone else. And we'll see you all tomorrow at noon.
Great day. Enjoy
for more
August.
Liquid Lunch right here on thatchannel.com.
Yeah.
See you then.
Just one kiss, it was just one night, one walk in the park. It was just one moon, it was just two hands and two beating hearts, and a little help from above. It turned out to be the kiss before love.
It was just one smile. Just one voice.
It was was just two hands.
You were my choice.